So if you were in the Regency era middle class, hoping to marry up into the upper landed gentry and nobility class, what would you do? Could you do it? And if you could, how would you pull it off? Today, we'll be going over exactly the steps you would need to take in order to be able to move up a class. My name is Ellie Dashwood, and this is my channel where we talk about history and apparently marrying up into the aristocracy of England. If you like either of those topics, then definitely subscribe. In one of my recent videos, we talked all about the class hierarchy during this time and how social mobility wasn't really a thing. It certainly was not like it is today. And more particularly, we talked about how there were spheres of life where you could move up within the sphere, you could move down within the sphere, but it was incredibly, extremely hard to move from one sphere to the sphere above it. But that did not stop some people from dreaming and hoping that they could pull this off. And more particularly, we saw this in the middle class, specifically the upper middle class. We're going to be talking here today, especially about perhaps those in trade or those in manufacturing and what steps they would take to try to get themselves from being just part of the middle class to being upper class. And their ability to do this was dependent on four main factors. They were money, manners, marriage, and manner. So let's dive into those. So first up, money. Obviously, then as now, money opens many doors. And if you were in trade hoping to break into the upper class, then what you needed to do was have a lot of money, like a lot of it. Like as much money as you possibly can get. And like I talk about in my video on whether Mr. Darcy is actually rich, there were some major merchants who made just as much money as those in the social 1%. And those were the people in particular who could start to qualify to cross this upper class boundary. One of you guys asked this question in the comments once of like, were there better trades to be in socially? Because of course, as we know from my video, How to Be a Lady or Gentleman in Jane Austen's time, that being in trade in general was something looked down upon by those of a higher class. Look who has come to visit us. Say hi. Say hi to the people. So the answer is yes. All trades were not equal. In fact, there were even some considered as a very, I guess you would say, noble trade. They still weren't ideal, but if you were going to be in trade, you would want to be in trade at a very large scale. So if you were dealing as a merchant of luxury goods, such as wine, then that would have been considered a more noble or socially acceptable form of trade to be in. Gotta put you down. And this is, of course, opposed to somebody who owns a shop. Like, if you are a shopkeeper or the child of a shopkeeper, you just have one little store that sells candlesticks or something, then that was pretty much at the bottom of the scale of trade. And honestly, if that was the level of trade your family is engaged in, at that point, it would have been pretty much impossible for you to break into the upper class, because that would be, of course, one of the lowest forms of trade, and only those in these very respectable lines of trade would qualify, which is very interesting because, as we are told in Pride and Prejudice, Elizabeth's uncle, Mr. Gardiner, is in a respectable line of trade in London, and it also talks about him having warehouses. So here we see him as a perfect example of somebody who is in trade on a large scale and makes quite a bit of money from it. But you might still notice, even though Mr. Gardiner is at that top level of trade, he's still looked down upon. And so exactly how can someone in his position transfer over from being just this guy in trade to helping his family become more high class? Well, if he's making enough money, he can embark on requirement number two, which is manners. So once you make sure that you're in the right type of trade, you're making enough money, what you need to use that money to do is to try to adopt the manners, lifestyle, recreation, education of the upper class. You have to go to the right opera be seen in the right places. You had to send your daughters to the most fancy and expensive schools in town so that they can get all of those required accomplishments to be a lady. And to learn more about what they would need to learn at those schools, definitely check out my video, Regency Era Girls Education. I'm not sure why I suddenly said that in like this really deep tone of voice. We're going with it there. Basically, what you would need to do is become socially and visually through your dress and lifestyle as much like the class you want to join as possible. Which is interesting because when we're talking about playing the part and looking the part, it reminds me of the scene when Elizabeth and the gardeners visit Pemberley and Mr. Darcy's coming up to meet them and he's being all nice and Elizabeth thinks this. What will be his surprise, thought she, when he knows who they are? He takes them now for people of fashion. Right? She's like, they appear so fashionable. That's what he thinks they are. But they're secretly not. They're in trade. And I think this does show that the gardeners are doing a great job of appearing to be of the class above them. Not to mention they have impeccable manners and taste. And how they behave and conduct themselves, which also recommends them to the upper class. And one of the things they would definitely imitate the upper class in was liking this video. I'm sure every upper class person in the Regency era would have liked my videos if they had the internet. And likewise, if you would like to like this video too, I would greatly appreciate it. Thank you. So once you have now essentially learned to imitate the class you want to become, the third thing to do is marry your daughters off to them, if at all possible. And there's one major way to make that possible, and it's called money. So like I mentioned, you need to make sure that your daughters are completely trained to be perfect, fashionable, elegant, accomplished ladies. Once that happens, what you need to do is then add the most important piece to this puzzle, money, in the form of a dowry or fortune. So exactly how much money does your daughter need to be desirable to a man of the upper class? And the answer is they need a fortune greater than the fortune of young women who belong to that class. So for example, both Emma Woodhouse and Georgiana Darcy have £30,000. And that was a pretty common amount of a fortune to give a daughter in the upper class. Obviously, some families in the upper class gave their daughters a lot more. Some gave them a lot less. But at that level of great family, $30,000 was about the average. So how much money would your daughter need? Well, over 30,000, and significantly over 30,000. We're talking 50,000, 60,000. Pretty much you have to make your daughter's fortune irresistible to a man from the upper class who is short on money. Yeah, it's kind of that simple. Basically, if there's an upper class man and he can marry an upper class girl and get the same amount of money as your daughter has, then he's going to do that. He's going to marry within his own class. But by making your daughter's fortune extra large and tempting, that is what's going to cause him to step over class lines to marry her. Because remember in my video on class, I was talking about how like they don't really like to go over class lines, especially if they don't have to. And pretty much making sure your daughter has a lot of money and he needs money is one of those ways to get him to do the thing he doesn't really want to do, which is marry outside of his class, but he's going to do it anyway because, well, money. But again, that money also has to be paired with the fact that your daughter is capable of acting, living, and appearing as part of his class because he also doesn't want to be embarrassed by his wife socially. Now, what's really interesting about this aspect is this is something we might be seeing happen in Sense and Sensibility. So Miss Grey in Sense and Sensibility has £50,000, which you'll notice is significantly more than £30,000. But that doesn't necessarily mean that she's coming from trade. In fact, we don't have a lot of information about who her family is, except for the fact that her parents are dead and her family is known for being super rich. But one thing that makes me think that possibly her money might have been made in trade, other than the fact of her high dowry, is that she marries Willoughby. So it's always been kind of this question of like, why on earth does Miss Grey marry Willoughby? She knows he's a rake and a scoundrel. He's in debt. He's not even nice to her. He's in love with another woman. Meanwhile, she's super rich. Well, why does she marry him? And one possible answer is that if her family did make money in trade, by her marrying Willoughby, she gains social standing. Because as horrible as Willoughby is, he is still a landed gentleman with an estate of his own. And now she will have the standing of being the wife of a landed gentleman, which is a definite step up for her socially. And so while obviously once the daughter marries into the upper class, that is now her standing and position in society, that doesn't mean that necessarily the upper class forgets where she comes from. And I think this is perfectly demonstrated in Jane Austen's Emma, where, you know, Emma definitely remembers the fact that Mrs. Elton's family made their money in trade. But at the same time, she treats her with the respect and courtesy of being a clergyman's wife versus how she's very hesitant to interact with the people who are still in trade, which are the Coles. So Mrs. Elton definitely married up socially into a higher social standing. But that doesn't mean anybody forgot where her money came from. But by marrying your daughters off into these families, this still helps you in the fact that you're now building connections. But basically, who you were related to, whether by blood or marriage, was important. It was like social currency. And just by having a daughter married to someone notable of the upper class would give your whole family a social boost. Which I do have to say this for the Gardner family, because Lizzie marries Darcy, they have some serious connections going on now. And this may actually help when it's time to start marrying off their own children. Be like, yeah, Mr. Darcy's my cousin. I go to Pemberley all the time. I'm from such a rich, fancy family. So the fourth step or thing to do to help move your family up is to use your money to buy land. Yes, this is the manor section. I just labeled it manor, so it kept the M theme going there. Anyway, basically, if you could get enough money and buy land, you would now be breaking into being a landed gentleman, right? Like, you're moving your whole family up. And of course, the ideal would be to eventually be able to buy enough land or have enough money to essentially stop being in trade and try to transition over into just being a member of the gentry. And of course, this is something we actually see happening in Pride and Prejudice with Mr. Bingley. His father made their family fortune in trade, and now Mr. Bingley has the family fortune of £100,000 invested. And this is a question somebody asked in the comments too, of where does Mr. Bingley's money come from, and this is where that £100,000 that's invested. And what's super interesting about the way that his income is stated in Pride and Prejudice, it includes a degree of uncertainty because of an important factor. In fact, in chapter one, when Mrs. Bennett is breaking the news to her husband that Mr. Bingley's coming to the area, this is what she has to say about his income. A single man of large fortune, $4,000 or $5,000 a year. What a fine thing for our girls. Okay, have you ever wondered why is it $4,000 or $5,000 a year? And the answer is, of course, money that is invested during this time period was usually invested in something either called the 4% or the 5%, which is the amount of interest that money would earn. So 4% would earn 4% interest, which on £100,000 is £4,000, and at 5% it would be £5,000. And Mrs. Bennett doesn't know because she doesn't know at which percentage he has his money invested. And one of those things that Mr. Bingley is supposed to be doing with his money is buying an estate and being a country gentleman. But Mr. Bingley, being him, he just can't decide what to buy. And that drives his sisters crazy, like I talk about in my video on how to be a Regency era gentleman or lady. So again, check that out if you want to learn more. So those were the major steps somebody in the very upper middle class coming from trade would have to take in order to try to break into the upper class. But what if you weren't from the highest most part of the middle class? What if you were just middle class or even lower middle class? Your dad really does just own a shop selling candlesticks. Could you still, maybe through marriage, make it into the upper class? Well, not very often, and if you did, you faced social disgrace, ostracism, ridicule, and just general disapproval. That would be seen as you trying to jump way too far from the bottom of your social sphere into the next one up, would be definitely looked down upon by society. And I think we see this attitude really well represented in this conduct book called Letters to a Young Lady. And of course, a conduct book during this time period was essentially a self-help book. They were really popular. They taught young women about how they should think, how they should feel. They were kind of intense. In fact, I talk more about conduct books in my video on one called How to Be the Ideal Regency Girl, where I dive into Fordyce's sermons, which is, yes, the book that Mr. Collins likes to read to his fair cousins, but they don't really appreciate it. And this addresses the issue of girls trying to marry up into the class above them. Anyway, it says, so with respect to disparity of fortune, I do not mean to estimate it by mere weight of metal when other considerations are equal. It is my wish to warn young women from aiming at conquests on the score of their personal attractions, to which neither their birth, connections, education, nor situation entitle them to aspire. So basically starts out with saying, I'm not just talking about metal or money. Girls who do not have the social standing with those education and position that he's talking about have no right to even dream of making a great match. Then it says, if the erratic pursuers of happiness would candidly state their discoveries, we should probably accede to the proposition that everyone is happiest in the state of life to which they have been accustomed. A young woman of humble connections and inferior accomplishments who is engrafted into an honorable stock will experience mortifications from the family to which she is allied that can only be parried by effrontery or stupidity. So first he's like, everyone's happiest in their own class. And then he's like, if you do manage to make a good marriage, the family you marry into will just be constantly mortifying you. She will also be conscious of improprieties and omissions, which nothing but an early initiation into high life would have taught her to avoid. Basically, you won't know how to behave properly, you'll be embarrassing yourself all the time. And even the glittering equipage which so forcibly struck her youthful fancy will seem but a painful conveyance if it pass by the amusement that she could have enjoyed and set her down at what she detests. Basically, if before you were married, you were like, wow, that carriage, it's so fancy. I want a carriage like that. Well, once you're married and you've been mortified and humiliated and you make mistakes everywhere and you're going to, say, some fancy ball where you know you'll just be mortified even more, well, you'll be in it and you're like, this fancy carriage is awful. I wish I stayed poor. Look at that low-class entertainment. I wish I was going there. But no, I'm stuck hanging out with rich people. So many sad things were happening for these girls marrying above their station in the Regency era. And you also might notice throughout this whole quote, how there was this assumption that the girl wouldn't know how to behave properly, which is one of the reasons why on that list of the four things you need to do to marry up was imitating in manners and lifestyle the upper class as much as you could, so that when you did marry your kids off, they would be fine in that class and their whole life wouldn't be one long series of mortifications. Anyway, let me know in the comments below, if you were in trade in the middle class in the Regency era, would you be trying to move up in society through marriage or buying land? Let me know in the comments down below. Anyway, I hope you enjoyed this video and keep having an awesome day, because you're awesome. Bye!